Then I would like to welcome all of you to this storytelling workshop for the Home with Rabbi Abetz. It's a preparation. It's a great way to get together with all of you to discuss what storytelling could mean and how important we could, how we could use it for our rivers and to make the Home with Rabbi Abetz a successful event that can really speak for your river. As maybe some of you know a bit, like, we've never been pushing for big numbers with the Home River Bio Blitz. We've never been pushing for like 1,000 number, you know, like the big number of observations, but we really want your reasons and your motivation to speak. So your connection to the river and having a workshop like this, we would really like to focus on this aspect of it so that the things that really speak for you can come out during the event, and that we can also maybe use this event as a moment to get it to some media and to really speak for the river. No? So we have three people speaking today. First, we'll have Gael from NetGeo, and she's leader in South America. She'll introduce herself a bit. Super exciting you're here. A lot of experience in storytelling and working with a lot of storytellers. So I'm sure that's going to be a good inspiration as a start for the session. Then we'll head over to Roxanne, who's a communications consultant and who's been doing a lot of communication for a lot of NGOs, and mostly in Europe. And she started writing a little idea for a press release and is going to help us to actually get hands-on with that. And then we'll have Enya, who's, you probably know her from our social media. She's been really active on our Instagram, and she's going to share some ideas and tips for your own Home River BioBlitzes. So cool. I'll head over to Gael.
Thank you, Vera. And thank you for the invitation. I'm happy to be here. So I'm I don't think I know everyone in this call. I'm Gael. I work at National Geographic Society. I'm the executive director for Latin America. And what that means is that I oversee all of the work that we're doing in Latin America, not only the work that we're doing in terms of programmatic work, things that we implement in the region, but also I follow up with all of the grants that we have provided in Latin America. So I work a lot with our explorers, grantees, in terms of how are they implementing their projects. And more importantly, I try to connect explorers. I kind of like, not kind of, we're like building a network of explorers around the globe, but more importantly, regionally and sometimes country-based, so that our grantees can have more impact and they can like really collaborate among each other and create the change that we need all together. So for me to see this, how this project has evolved, is really, really inspiring, because it started like a collaboration. So it's really amazing. I'm gonna share my screen. I hope it was, this presentation is going to be different from what I normally do, because one, I don't have a lot of time. I know that not all of you are storytellers, so this has to be different, because you're not photographers, you're not journalists, you're not like that profile that I normally work with in terms of this kind of workshops. So I was thinking, what could be like relevant for me to say and to share with all of you in 20 minutes that can really help you for what you're going to do and for the future, for this type of events or this type of engagement that you want to do in your own world, or if you are doing conservation, if you're doing research. All of what we do, and I'm sure that applies to everybody in this call, all of us, we're trying to make change, right? We're trying to create a different reality from what we have right now. And for that, we're trying to have an engagement with an audience, with people that we want them to have awareness or to do something. So I'm going to focus a lot on how can we start that conversation with the other, no? And how this Home River BioBlitz, this activity specifically that we're doing in the next few days, how do we use that as a starting point of that conversation that we can keep ongoing and that we can like reactivate next year if we do another one? And this is like the perfect setting to start that kind of conversation. So I'm going to share my screen. You're watching now, right? Like, let me, is it okay? Perfect, okay. So the first thing I would like to like really reflect on, and this is an open conversation. So if somebody wants to answer one of these questions, I would love to hear at least one people saying something. As I was mentioning, we're all working to create an impact that we all consider is a positive impact for the world, for our communities, for our rivers, for our ecosystems, everything. So I would love to hear personally of all of you, what is a change you want to make or see happen? And how are you going to make that change a reality? And let's put it more in terms of, why are you doing this? Like, why did you got engaged on this activity of the Home River BioBlitz? Why do you want to do your BioBlitz? Why making all of this effort of inviting people, that day going out, doing all of this? Why? Let's not talk in general about the change we want to see in the world. What is exactly the change you want to see by doing this activity of the BioBlitz? So if anyone wants to, and I just want one person, if someone can share their answer for the first one, and then probably another one can share for the second one, it could be amazing. But I don't see anybody because I'm seeing only my screen. So
can I answer the first question?
Yes.
So what I would love, so the change I want to see happen is attachment to people, to feel more attached to their ecosystem and to the other beings they live within.
Perfect. Thank you, Jens. And for the second one, who wants to share?
Okay, me.
Perfect.
I want to achieve the change by showing my community that the rivers around me are alive and kicking and they are not dead.
Okay, perfect. So it's interesting, right? Because two different people answer two different questions and the answers are very similar in terms of the intention that you have, right? You want to create an attachment, you want to create a link to the river and to what surrounds the river. And then Carlos wants to do more or less the same. He wants to show people that live around the river that the river is alive. Bring the water of the river into life, no? And I guess that all of that intention is because you want people to have a different attitude towards the river, right? You want them to take care of the river. You want to take the river into consideration. You want people to see that the river is part of their lives. So when we're talking about storytelling for impact, these are the first things that we have to have very clear in the top of our minds. As individuals, as organizations, as a group of people, whatever you want to say, like in terms of whatever you want to define it. And I think it's even better when you have this kind of questions answered as a group, because that will give you the collective answer to what you're trying to do as a collective. And that will give you like a collective goal and vision for that impact that you want to create. But it also works individually, because if you have like, if I hear Jens and I hear Carlos answering these kinds of questions and I see the, and I hear these answers, I see that they have a common point and they can work together to achieve that impact. And they can build a narrative, they can build a story together to achieve that. right? So, and we, like, you don't know how many times, even with storytellers, I don't see, it's hard to get to these answers, and it's hard to approach the, like, how to build a story answering these questions first. It's hard because you're addressing, one, the impact, but also this will give you guidance into who are you going to talk to and how are you going to tell the story so that you can really create that conversation and that impact. So let me go to the next one. And why is hard? Why is it so hard to create an impact in terms of creating a story and making the change that we want to see in the world? I think there are many reasons, but there are two that for me I want to like underline today. One, all of the audience, the people that we're trying to engage in our conversation, all of us included, we're very distracted. We're overwhelmed with messages, images, videos, social media, all of it is all around. So everybody, the span of attention that we all have is very small. So we need to be very creative in terms of how are we gonna craft a message, because people are not paying attention. Or they will be paying attention, but for a very limited amount of time. Okay, so in general, let's assume and let's take this as, this is a reality. The audience, the people that we wanna start the conversation with is gonna be distracted. So how are we going to call for their attention and send a clear message so that we can at least get that seed planted in their hearts or in their brains or in whatever you wanna call it, in their souls or whatever. And the other thing is that we always, like most of the time, we give a very confusing message. Like our message starts with, sometimes we, and people, especially people, for example, doing research, they try to like kind of explain why they're trying to do what they're trying to do with very scientific jargon, and then everybody gets lost, no? So we're, and or we don't give a clear call to action. So people don't know what to do. Like, oh, great. I love that, Jens, you love the rivers and that you want everybody to feel attached to the river, but there's no call to action for me. Like there's nothing in your message for me to do or for me to think about. So, or we're talking about too many things in the message. We're talking about citizen science, river conservation, traditions, knowledge. And what is the thing you want? What's my takeaway? I don't see the takeaway. I don't find the message. I'm confused. So as soon as I get confused, I'm just gonna leave it behind because I don't wanna get confused. And I have many other things to worry about. So I think those are two key elements to take into consideration when we're thinking about the stories and the message we wanna give. The audience is distracted, and then we're very confusing in terms of how we give the message. The clear, like the simple, the shorter, and a message that has a call to action, the better. People, the span of attention is short. So if I'm clear, if I give them a call to action, and if I give one message, I stay with one message, the better. So let's dig a little bit more about the audience, especially for this project. All of you are going to do the BioBlitz in different countries, with different contexts, with different communities. And I bet that all of those communities have different level of engagements with their environment, with their river, with the, it's completely different. So it's very important for all of you to have a clear idea of who is your audience. Who are you targeting? Is it only the participants of the BioBlitz, the people that are going to be present that day or doing all of the activities? Or probably your message is not for those people who are already engaged. probably what you want to do is after the BioBlitz or during the BioBlitz, you want to reach another kind of audience that it's more like country-based or more general, to invite them to do this kind of activities. I don't know, you know better than me. So I would love to know if anybody participating in this call already has like some clear idea of who is your project aimed at? How do you plan to reach this public or this audience? And what do you want to generate in them? And let me explain this last one. While communication is all about the, let's put it as individuals. If I am doing a conversation with Vera, I have a message to provide to Vera, and I'm all, like, I will expect a reaction from Vera. And that reaction is probably, Vera, I need you to please pass me my coffee, or Vera, I need you to think about how like I need your advice on how to solve this problem. Or but having a conversation with someone else, in this term, it could be in this like sense, it could be a community, an audience in general, whatever. You're expecting a response because you're expecting to have a conversation. So when I'm asking, what do you want to generate in them, in that audience, in that public, is what do you want them to do? Or what do you want them to reflect? Or what do you want them to feel? Like, what are the kinds of things you're expecting to see happen? That relates to the first question that I was doing in the first slide. So anyone wants to share their thoughts about any of these questions? Or if no one wants to share them, start writing them down, because this is going to be related to one of the one exercise that I have after an example that I want you to see. And I think if we can start answering these questions, it's going to be much more easier for all of you to create those messages that you want to provide during the BioBlitz or after or before the BioBlitz. So
I could say something?
Yep.
You don't wanna. No, I'm organizing a BioBlitz in a place where that's affected by hydropower plants, no? And it's one valley where we are gonna do the BioBlitz, where we definitely want to create awareness about the biodiversity, but mostly we want to see the different effects or the different people that are affected by the hydropower, and actually make the biodiversity people, so to say, aware of all those different audiences as well, so to say. Mm-hmm. So we're one next step after the BioBlitz is kind of to make a map with the input of the BioBlitz, but also get the concerns of the farmers there, to get the concerns of the, like, even that drinking water might be gone, stuff like that. Mm-hmm. To all kind of link it together. So what we hope to reach, to generate, is this feeling of like, how do you say this, connectedness between different aspects.
So this is a really interesting example, Vera, because the BioBlitz becomes like the first step to do a more long-term engagement, right? So your project is mainly aimed to create that long-term engagement with this community, and what you want to generate with them is this commitment and this sense of connectiveness, not only to everybody, but probably among them, to then carry out this effort together and learn, like having this learning experience together, no? And sharing information and creating it. And it's a different approach because, and I'm gonna jump to the next one, because here, for example, and it relates to the questions that we have been seeing, the key points we need to have is, you have your intention, no? The intention is, this is the first step to create a more of a long-term commitment to do these maps. And then why is this community going to care? Because this is related to water that is available for them and the quality of water they have available for them. That's why they should care. And what is a call to action for them? Create the map. Let's create the map. Let's do this analysis of where the water is, the quality of water, to then we can take action. Because unless we have the map and all of this activity together, we cannot have that second action that we want to see happening. So I don't know if I'm being clear on how to, like, you're kind of getting to the level of getting more clear what you want to create. And these three key points for me, if we have this clear, it's going to be much more easier then to see after the bio leads, after you created the map, the impact that you had. And you can really have a learning experience in terms of what worked and what didn't work. So the storytelling for impact also becomes a learning experience on how to implement a project. It's not only, here's a press release, here's a social media thing that we want to do, and then you forget about it. You never come back. And or that is just a simple reading of, we had 5,000 likes. Great, but those 5,000 likes just last for 3 minutes or for 1 day or for a week. And then that means that people are now caring for rivers? Probably not, right? So how can we also create this storytelling actions, learning experiences, where we can become better in terms of how do we convey our messages? And one of the examples, I was thinking about the examples that I wanted to show, and I'm gonna just show you one because of the sake of time. And it's with the one project that we have that is called PhotoArc. And if we go back to these questions, let's keep these questions. What is the intention? Why should I care? What's the call for action? So, intention. This project was proposed and is implemented by one of our explorers who is called Joel Sartor. Joel has been a wildlife photographer for years and years and years, and he has done all kind of work and everything. At one point of his life, he had like this very hard family situation, and he had to stay at home for many, many, many months, many weeks, which he hasn't, like, he was used to be traveling all around the world, not staying in the same place. One day he has to stay at home for many months, and that changed the way he was approaching his work. And one of the things he was like looking into the work he had been done for years and years was, even though we're conveying the message that biodiversity is under threat, we keep losing biodiversity. Like, we're not really creating the change we want to see. And he had been doing a lot of work with endangered species that are under threat of becoming extinct. And that's when he started like really realizing like there's a couple of species that right now is almost impossible to to have a photo of them in the wild because they're almost extinct. So how can I get someone to feel any kind of empathy or awareness of those species if they don't see them? So because he really believes that looking into the eye, and that's why I left this phrase that he always repeats, look, that eye contact between the probably the animal and the person is what makes the desire for you to help them, to create, like, that is what really can move you in terms of heart and soul to say, we need to do something, right? So that's when he decided that he wanted to do a project about trying to do that connection between the person that sees the photo with the animal that is almost extinct and that you can probably not see in the wild anymore. And it's gonna be really hard. So he created PhotoArc, which is, I wanna have a photo of all of those animals that are almost extinct, impossible to see in the wild. And I'm gonna take those photos as studio photos because those animals are in refugees, zoos, and yeah, in those conditions. And that's how he started. And he started this project of photo arc. So again, I'm in this one. What is the intention of Joel with this project? So there is a clear intention. I want to create that eye contact. Let's move their heart and soul and see what happens. So then why your audience is going to care? So right now, this is the amount of species he has in photos. And what he wants to do is like this, no? The power of photography, inspire people. Let's protect those species before they're lost. And it's documenting all of this in the zoos and wildlife sanctuaries. This is why we should care. We're talking about more than 30,000 species that are at risk. And this is only the ones he has in photos. There are more. We should care because we're losing this, no? That's more or less why, like, it's more elaborated than that, but it's more or less the message. And then the alarm for that species that are at risk is let's save together. And they created the hashtag and they create, like, why are this, like, if with all of the funds that we're fundraising, we're trying to help also the people that are helping the species to recover in the wild. Like, there's many other elements, but there's a call to action. And my call to action is let's save together. That doesn't mean that you have to go into the wild or you have to do certain things. That means that the save together can mean different actions that people can take. And depending on where you are and how and your possibilities, but there's a call to action, right? And yes, you can. It can go from a donation, like I will press that button and then I will donate, to other things, no? To take action in the field, and if you like really learning, there's material for educators. There's many possibilities for you to get engaged. But what I want to show you with this example is. You build it because you had in the beginning a clear idea of what you want to create in the other, in your audience. And then you go from there to how you convey the message to your audience that they should care, that they should be taking action. And then you give them the item of how to take action. So that's why I want you to invite to do for the BioBlitz that you're all doing. And this is why I have this exercise that we don't have to do now because we don't have time, but try to do it on your own. Use one or two words to describe the topic of your project. Like the topic is something like what Jen said at the beginning. I want them to create attachment. Or what Vera said, I want them to feel connected. So because you can evolve all of the message around those words. Then in one sentence, describe why they need to care. Why, Vera, you want that community to care? Because it's their water. It's the water that they will be drinking and they will be using and they have to preserve, no? And then in one sentence, provide a call to action. As clear as you can. If you don't give people a call to action, it's very hard for them to get engaged and to care, and to follow up with you, and to start a conversation with you. So I am going to leave it here, especially because I think we don't have any more time. And if there are any questions, we can do it at the end, right? I don't know how you want to do this, Vera.
If there's any questions now, that is totally open also to be asked. I'm also happy if somebody has a clear idea already about this exercise to just have one person reflecting on it now. If somebody
comes. Should we write it down in the chat?
That would be great.
I'm gonna put the questions in the chat.
So any reflections or any clear questions? Another Francisco.
I would think that it would be useful to have a call to action, a hashtag, for example, for the whole global project, Home River BioBlitz, but also have one for the local rivers. you know, because each river will have its own problems, its own connection or not connection with the people. So to have a global one, and then each group in each river try to come up with a hashtag for their rivers.
I think that also adds to the idea of like everyone can make their BioBlitz work for their cause, no? Everybody has their own story in a way.
So we would have two calls of action, one general and one more local. Also, for those watching from Mexico, September is the worst month for me because it's where the day of the independence was demo in Chile. So the whole month, it's very patriotic, jingoistic. Mexico is the best and all that. So I think my idea here in Mexico, in Torreón, would be to try to connect the notion of homeland, of country, of the place you belong to the river, not to some abstract idea of a flag and the national song and all that. River is our home, the river is our country, the river is our homeland. Something like that. Try to revert that jingoistic approach to a more place-based approach.
Cool. Yeah, good ideas. It can be on different levels, different messages, no? Very locally, nationally, worldwide. Gael, thanks a lot for this really inspiring talk and motivating us to really think through our message again, thinking what motivates us and what we want to get across. I think those few questions you posed are super helpful to just reflect on that for each person. So we'll share that with everyone. I think it is a good link towards Roxanne. So first of all, thanks a lot, Gael, for joining us. And then Roxanne, maybe also a link with Francisco. I think he was the first one that got one article in the media. And Roxanne has been preparing a bit of a press release and thought about the message as well. So Roxanne, for us, yours now.
Yes, thank you, Vera. And thanks everyone for having me here. Thanks, Gael, for that really interesting talk. And it's just a perfect kind of prelude into what I want to talk. I know you mentioned, you know, press releases, social media, I just kind of threw it out there, but it's still important sometimes too. And certainly having the story already there and, you know, the goal, the message, the audience differentiated in your mind is helpful for this work as well when you're thinking about your press releases or your media alerts. But before I start my presentation, maybe just a little bit about me. So I am Roxanne. I am based in Barcelona, Spain, and I'm a communications consultant, like Vera mentioned earlier, and I've worked on several freshwater campaigns in Europe. So one that I'm working on currently is Save the Blue Heart of Europe, which focuses on protecting rivers in the Balkans from hydropower. And then I also work on the European Open Rivers Program team, which is a grant giving organization dedicated to providing funds for small dam removals in Europe. So opening up rivers and restoring them in that way. So yes, let me share my screen. I will share, present. Okay, so home river BioBlitzers take over the media. Obviously this is fake, but so I will be talking to you all about press releases and media alerts and the importance of also getting your event in the media. You know, you definitely want to attract people to your event. Like I'll mentioned, having that specific audience in mind. And one audience I think definitely you don't want to discount is journalists or people on the radio or podcasters or, you know, TV news persons. So we'll talk a little bit about how to engage them today in a brief 101 crash course. So press release versus a media alert. So A press release is essentially kind of just giving information to, let's just use journalists as an example, about your event or, you know, whatever it is, this new and exciting thing that you want to talk about and let this journalist know. So a press release is more so of a narrative, providing more details about your event, you know, giving this why context as well. So a little bit above about the story, you know, mentioning the storytelling aspect of it, the why of your event, and the, well, mostly who, what, when, where, why. So the five W's. We'll talk about that later as well. And a press release is typically longer than a media alert, and it's to a larger audience. So typically a press release, you can give it to your local media or newspapers, but you can also give a press release to national media or international media, because in your press release, you can make this, you know, you can dive into local scenarios, but then pull it out into why is this important nationally for our country, you know, this river specifically. And then you would also send out a press release when that press release is relevant. So the Home River BioBlitz is happening the same weekend as the World Rivers Day. So maybe you want to send out the press release on the World Rivers Day to let the press know that you are doing this event. Or you want to send out a press release after the event saying, hey, here's what happened, why this is important, why people should engage. Then we have a media alert. So a media alert is just an invitation, basically. You're inviting press to your event. You want them to cover your event. And so this is very basic and is typically shorter than one page and answers those, again, those five W questions: who, what, when, where, why. And because you're inviting them to your event, it's typically catered to more so your community outlets. So your local news, newscasters or TV stations, or your local newspaper and journalists. So generally you want to send out an alert 2 weeks in advance, or you can send it out a few days in advance, but you definitely want to get on their calendar, make them aware that this is happening, and then perhaps like a little nudge reminder the day before the event, hey, don't forget about our event tomorrow. So those are the kind of differences between a press release and a media alert. So and now I'm going to go into a bit of a broad overview of how to write one. So you will have a headline in a press release, and we'll do also the template, an example of a press release. So you have your headline, and it's important. So Gael also mentioned about capturing the attention of your audience. The journalist is the same. They're very busy people. They want to know right away what they're looking at. So a catchy headline, and then maybe a sentence or two, small summary, that's also, you know, highlights what you're about to talk about. Then you have the date. You mentioned the date and location, and the body of your press release is mostly looks like this. So we call this an inverted pyramid. So at the top of your press release, and as most of your press release, is going to be the most newsworthy information. What do you want to tell this journalist? What, you know, these five W's, what do you want them to know? Where is it happening? Why are you doing this? Who is doing this? Things like that. Then you can kind of bring more details, still important details, further down into a main body of the press release, and then kind of bring it out to more general. So again, kind of giving it national or international context. And then you're ending or closing your press release by summarizing and highlighting the relevance or summarizing, highlighting your main message of the press release. At the end, you have something called a boilerplate, and you give your contact information, and we'll go over that in a moment. So that's your press release. Then a media alert is a lot shorter. So it's basically very brief. So you have the brief headline again. I mean, this is like, think about if you're inviting someone to your birthday, you're not going to give them a 2-page or telling them why you should go to your birthday, but it should also be brief for the journalists, right? Brief headline, maybe a sub headline, talking about a little bit about the details, then these 5 W's, you're not going to forget about them after today. Your contact information, and then maybe any extra additional information you might want that journalist to know about. So this might be something that you all might choose to do to invite the local media to your event. And maybe you do it beginning of next week, you send them a media alert, hey, just so you know, this weekend, we're, you know, gathering here, we're doing this, you know, this is our organization. And then afterwards, you might write the press release about what happened, telling more of that story and integrating, you know, this call to action, again, that you all were talking about earlier. So that was super brief, and I'll kind of go through our template that I've put together for you all, just to give you a sense of what I'm talking about. I don't know, I think this is viewable, right? You can read it. Okay, so here, typically on a press release, you can have your logo on the top. So if it's organized by an organization, sent by an organization, you typically insert your logo. Then you have your title, which is capturing, again, the journalist's attention, your byline or the summary of what your press release is about. Then I mentioned the location and the date. This always goes here. And then you have basically the who, what, when, where, why in the beginning of your press release. This is what's capturing. So these first 2 paragraphs, sometimes within the first paragraph, you really want to extract that information and say, hey, if the journalist only reads 2 paragraphs, this is what they want to read. Sometimes in a press release, there's also a quote from the organizer, a person within the organizing team, and they kind of give a personal perspective on the importance of your Home River BioBlitz and or why, you know, it's relevant in the community, things like that. So that kind of helps to bring in the people aspect of it, I think. And then again, we're going a bit out, you know, more general information about the river or the Home River BioBlitz as well. I've given some example of things that you could possibly say or take from about the Home River BioBlitz. Obviously, the Home River BioBlitz is, you know, this global citizen community, and the idea is to connect each other, and you're exploring the wildlife and you want to create awareness about the rivers. Then you have the closing paragraph. So highlighting your message, reiterating it one more time, and your end. So this will probably be 1 page long. Then the notes for the editors. So you definitely want to have some photos. So Gael mentioned the importance of photos, and her example even was of a photographer, you know, talking to people through these photos. You definitely want to have engaging photos, you know, clear, high quality photos, and have that available for the journalist to take. And also be sure to put the copyrights of the photos so the photographer gets the credit. Then you want to have your contact information. So who's a journalist going to contact to talk to about the event to get more information, maybe do an interview. And then you can also insert your boilerplate if you have one. This is just more information about your organization. I've inserted here about the Home River BioBlitz, given extra information to the journalist about what a BioBlitz is. It's a technical term, we call it a jargony term. So maybe someone might not know, and this is a place where you can give them the more information about rivers and streams. So that's essentially the makeup of your press release. Then a media alert, like I mentioned, is just super brief. You're just inviting them. You have your title, the, you know, one sentence kind of giving more details. Then literally you can put who, what, when, where, you know, and your contact informations. and additional information if you would like. This is even a lot of information, actually, but so that they can get a little bit more background if you don't think that they need to know a bit more about that. And we're going to share these press release and media alert with you so that you have these examples. But just to let you know, there are zillions of templates online that you can also pull from and get inspiration from as well. I was just going to show you some example photos. So these were from last year. Oh, dang it. Well, I only have the one. I can share those with you all later, but it should be just high quality sharing what the event was about. So who are you targeting when we're talking about journalists? So you could talk about news outlets, whether that be paper, actual newspapers, or that could be digital. So you're reading, the New York Times online, things like that, radio stations, TV stations. Typically, how I would engage is depending on your level of comfort, but also if you know the journalist, sometimes over time you can create relationships with journalists. You could email them about with your press release attached. And then I would probably do highlighting three main important points about the press release, and then in the body of the email. And then you can also call. That's a very effective way to get attention from these journalists. And my tip for you all is to look up specific outlets. And when I say outlets, I'm talking about, New York Times, Bloomberg, the names of the actual newspapers. Or specific journalists that have covered a similar topic, because they're already interested. They know a lot about maybe that specific river, maybe about freshwater in general, maybe about fish. So you have a higher likelihood to get them to write about your event or your story, whatever it would be. So this does require a little bit of research. If you see, so-and-so wrote about the Oder River last Wednesday, let's reach out to them and let them know what's going on with our river this Friday, things like that. And then hopefully after all this work, you've put together a press release, you've talked to the journalist that you want to talk to, and then they put together a news article for you. And these are just two from last year, actually. So you see they have a big photo up front of the river or the people who are engaging in the event. And obviously we would like to hear from you as well if you are able to get into the local news in your countries or in your communities. So that would be something great to share with the Home River BioBlitz team. And yes, that is it. And I hope that that was something that was useful for you all, and definitely we can answer any questions and we'll share the information with you after the meeting. Thanks.
Thanks so much, Roxanne. This was really good hands-on tips on doing this. I think writing a press release or getting in the newspaper seems something really far away and it should magically happen and you should make your event cool enough to get there or something, but clearly it's not magic and it's about just approaching the good people and getting your story, and with the storytelling tips of Gael, combination of this, I think it's a cool challenge to get on, and I think it's actually reachable now for a lot of people. Is there any questions to Roxanne? Just shows that it was super clear and everybody is ready to get on to the job. Thanks a lot, Roxanne, for sharing all of this. And indeed, we'll be sharing the templates on the Google Drive. Make sure you don't start using the template, but actually copy your own copy so that the template stays available for the next person as well. I think we'll have to add a line at the top or something so that people see that. But yeah, super exciting. Then Anya.
Thank you, Vera, and thank you, Gael and Roxanne, for all the learnings, and I'm super excited about all these things and the importance of sharing with others, not just in our local level, but in this Home River BioBlitz event, this international event. Well, my name is Enya. I've been working on the social media part of the Home River BioBlitz. I am a PhD student right now. I'm working on the topic of river health and citizen science, just working on the idea. And I learned about the Home River BioBlitz last year through social media. And I am not an expert on social media. I've been helping Home River BioBlitz. I think because I've been working on my own social media and I like photographing and sharing some insights about nature through photography. So I think that's why I'm working with Home River BioBlitz in social media. And now I'll share with you some ideas that we can create as the community working on the Home River BioBlitz. So I'll start sharing. Is it share? It is sharing?
Yes.
Cool. So about the Home River BioBlitz in social media, I'll first start that we will have a space in the drive where we all can upload our photos and videos from the event, the particular event. The last year, some of the participants, we upload them into different folders with the name of our river. Then in each folder, there will be space for video and photos. This video and photos are the one that I've been using to feed the social media in through these weeks before. And then for photos, an idea is to separate them in biodiversity, the river landscape, and the citizens and rivers. So in this order, I can identify which photos are from where, and also I can identify the different material that we can share in the social media. For the social media material, I'll be focusing on three main things. The first one is how the landscape, the river landscape and the citizen are connecting during this event. Then what types of river landscape are being seen around the world? And finally, what type of biodiversity the citizens have been found during this event? So in order to share it with the wider audience and the followers that Home River BioBlitz has, there are some photos of talking about citizens with the river, the river landscape. And if you want, when you are uploading the photos into the drive, you can put a short description about the photo, what is interesting about it, like how many people were in the event, or what type of river landscape are we viewing, seeing, like a river in the mountain, river in the coastal, and then what type of biodiversity does the citizens looked during this event. These are some examples. For example, in Ahuacapan, Jalisco, we took a photo where the citizens are observing the macroinvertebrates. They are chatting about it. What we want here is to share with other citizens that are like starting to know more about the Home River BioBlitz, what are the things that the citizens are doing during this event. So they can see the citizens are going inside the river, that they are looking some weird insects or something like that, that they are having fun. So these photos are very important. So it's kind of the examples that you can share it in the folders in the drive. Then about the river landscape, what it is important is to share with the wider audience what the different and diversity types of rivers, and also how those rivers can connect with other rivers or can be similar to our rivers. So that's very interesting. And the next one about the river, the type of the photo is the river biodiversity. You can share as much as you want, but we suggest to choose the one that you are most like linked with the photo, or you are most like impressed by it. For example, I found this photo of an insect very particular, which has very weird eyes. So this is very interesting to share because when you go out to the river and see the diversity of colors and smells and etc., you actually are finding and reconnecting with the diversity of these rivers. So these kind of photos are very important. You can take photos from an ant looking to the water, from a bird, or very shortly for a mushroom. All of these are very, very interesting for social media. Also, if you know the species of the animal or plant that you photographed, it's better that you put in the description when you upload it, so I can know what type of a species and we can share it in social media. This is about photos. I don't know if you have some questions about it. If not, I'll continue with the videos. Videos. Well, I think there will be a video for the end of the Home River Biobus event, which horizontal videos will be taken and will be very helpful. I think this will be talked later. But for social media, what we are interested more about, it's about the short videos. Short videos like 15 seconds, 30 seconds, where you can show us the path of the river, how the river is, where we can hear the roaring of the flowing river or the rocks. And also you can share with us some particularities of the citizens, if some citizens want to share with a wider audience about their experience or et cetera, we recommend to take those videos in a short, so I can upload it in Instagram as Reels, because it has more connection with wider audience. And yeah, these are some ideas. The topics that you can share through video will be the river sounds, share citizens' opinions and experience, or share the exploration path. Okay, and finally, I share with you some of the links and hashtags that you can share it with us, because I noticed that each of you have your own account for the Home River BioBlitz, or not for the Home River BioBlitz, but which has your own river project or your own river social media. So it's very interesting how you have been tagging us and share with us in the stories, your calls, your experience. So keep doing that. And you can keep doing that with these hashtags and tags. Yes. So that will be all for me. Thank you so much.
Thanks a lot, Anya. It's really cool to see how engaged you are now with the social media. This is a big step from last year where we were kind of doing it on the side. And just seeing that all your experience is building up and now is possible to share this with others.
I've been learning a lot. Like I wasn't like an expert in nothing, but I've been learning a lot.
I consider you an expert now. That was super cool. So indeed, encouragement for others also to share, to text, and this is a cool way to really get this global feeling, no? And to show that it's happening not only in North America, South America, but then there's somebody from Kenya and Indonesia, and it's pretty cool. And this is maybe once it's happening, it's almost in a week, more or less. I'll wake up to the first messages coming in, people in Indonesia already out, and then it just continues 24/7 for 3 days. And that's something like, I don't know how much you want to sleep, and yeah, but if you want, you could be resharing constantly, I think. You don't have to do that. You can just sleep as well, but this is super cool. Obviously, this was also only Instagram. We have a Twitter account as well, and I'm actually looking at Jens. We're just simply not that active on those accounts ourselves. If there would be somebody standing up saying like, hey, this is something I find fun to do, feel welcome in the team for next year. But yeah, social media is definitely another way to gain an audience, to gain a feeling and The more you've thought about the message you want to bring across, the better your story will be also there, no? So is there any questions, remarks after this session on storytelling from anyone on the globe? Then I would like to say a big thank you to Gael, Roxanne, and Anya to show the different sides of storytelling, the power of it, and to really like the motivation to get hands-on for our next week's homework for BioBlitz.
Good luck, everyone, in the BioBlitzes. Have fun.
Good luck. This is actually.
Thank you all. I see you all on your rivers sharing images in the WhatsApp group.
Yeah, I'm just how much this is the last. I think we'll send one more email out with just some reminders. Like, there's been a lot of information in the last few workshops, and we'll do a kind of recap so you have the information together, also those templates and all of that. But yeah, good luck. Enjoy the homework for BioBlitz and do share with us and enjoy the day out. Have fun.
Thank you.